My name is Martha Johnson. I'm director here at the Maier. And it's my pleasure to introduce Lee Quiñones, one of the most influential artists to emerge from the New York City subway art movement. He's a celebrated figure in both the contemporary art world and in popular culture circles, faithfully producing work that is ripe with provocative socio-political content and intricate composition. These paintings are housed in the permanent collections of the Whitney Museum of Art, the Museum of the City of New York, and museums in France, Germany, and the Netherlands. He has exhibited at the New Museum of Contemporary Art in New York City, the Museum of National Monuments in Paris, and the Städtische Museum in Germany. Born in Puerto Rico in 1960, Quiñones was raised in New York's Lower East Side in a family that kept close ties to their cultural heritage. By age 5, Lee showed a penchant for drawing, instinctively drawn to the colorful characters of his neighborhood and the more fantastical realm of Japanese post-war science fiction monster films, particularly the Godzilla series, and animation series such as Speed Racer and Kimba the White Lion. Film scores of the day resonated with Lee, who regularly attended screenings with his mother, and televised images of the Vietnam battlefields left a stirring impression about the nature of warfare. These cultural cues would later shape much of his work as he gravitated to the urban underground during the explosive 1970s in New York. Against the perilous backdrop of a fractured city, Lee painted his first subway piece in 1974, inspired by the leading figures of subway lore, including Cliff 159 of the Three-Yard Boys and Blade 1 of the Crazy Five. Lee began creating whole 40-foot subway car murals in late 1975. By 1976, Lee was a shadowy legend, leaving his fervent mark in a voracious whole subway car campaign. Over the next decade, he would paint an estimated 150 whole subway cars through the MTA system. In late 1975, Lee was asked to join the Fabulous Five, an elite quintet of seemingly mythic graffiti writers. The Fabulous Five's greatest feat, the only running 10-car train painted from top to bottom, end to end, made its legendary journey in November 1976. In the spring of 1978, Lee was instrumental in moving enamelist art above ground when he stealthily painted in one night Howard the Duck, the first entire 25-by-30-foot handball court mural situated outside his junior high school. Lee had his first solo exhibition at Claudio Bruni's Galleria La Medusa in Rome, Italy, late in 1979, which was also the first international show to feature graffiti-based art. 1 year later, Lee made his New York gallery debut at the White Collins Gallery, ushering in an era as spray paint made the transition from moving objects to stationary canvas. That same year, he was part of the seminal Times Square show, held in an abandoned massage parlor, that highlighted the postmodernist masters of the day, including Jenny Holzer, Keith Haring, Kiki Smith, Jane Dixon, and Jean-Michel Basquiat. Subsequent shows, including the Graffiti Arts Success for America at Fashion Moda in 1980 and the New York New Wave Show in 1981 at PS1 MoMA, were also instrumental in introducing his work to the watchful art world. Lee's international prominence led to a celebrated solo show, such as Rust-Oleum at the Fun Gallery, and exhibits at Barbara Gladstone, Sydney Janus, Riverside Studios, and his Werner Gallery. His paintings were included in the prestigious 1983 Documenta 7 held in Kassel, Germany. As his work gained widespread exposure, Lee found himself at the cross-section of two movements in their infancy, hip-hop and punk rock, which provided context for the direction of his work. Much of this influence was due to Fred Brathwaite, who sought out Lee in 1979. Lee credits Brathwaite, known as Fab Five Freddy, for single-handedly fusing uptown hip-hop flavor with a gritty downtown punk aesthetic. Lee starred in Charlie Ahern's 1983 film Wild Style, loosely written about Lee's life, endearing him to a generation of hip-hop fans. We will be screening Wild Style on Saturday, November 10th. An 80s dance party will immediately follow the screening. You'll not want to miss that, so mark your calendars. One last fun fact about Lee. In the aftermath of Hurricane Katrina, he raised $65,000 for the Boys and Girls Clubs of America by riding a bicycle from New York to Miami. For his humanitarian efforts, October 27th is officially Lee Quiñones Day in New York. Please join me.
My mother was a huge fan of film. got herself into these premieres somehow, some way, with me in tow. I don't know, I think it was that at that point that I really took a liking, a loving for music, theatrical music, music from the films, and Lalo Schifrin, and, you know, John Williams, and Andy Mancini, you know, Hans Zimmer, all those guys like made me feel the way I saw the world. And I saw the world through their music. And I also noticed that there was also a love for that type of music from the DJs that were DJing on the streets back then. This is way before hip-hop, or the notion of hip-hop even existed. This is right on the heels, you know, during the disco era, but the disco era was being mixed with, at least for the DJs in my neighborhood, were being mixed by, mixed with music from the great films of that day. The B-rated films, some of the action-packed films, but they just, I felt that that music coincided with the way I felt about the world. And I think that became my back wind, put the wind in my sails, if you want to say that, when I went into the subway yards late at night. Again, traveling into the subway yards was like crossing that bridge. I heard the gunshots right outside the subway yards. I felt the city falling apart, but I was in the safest place in my world, along with the third rail. So I'm going to play this. It's going to be a few segments. This segment is just like my love for music, but my love for the movement itself in New York, and how a little marking turned into a huge global art movement, probably the largest, arguably the largest art movement of its time. Of all time. What I like to say, by young people, for people of all ages. So I'm going to stop in between before I give you a little taste of my way, way, way back past. And we can talk, you can throw questions on me, apples, everything. Sit back, enjoy, and hear it through the visions.
Thank you.
Not be here today if it wasn't for people like Martha Cooper and Henry Chalfant and Jack Stewart and a number of other personalities that took it on their own to go down into the subways, up on rooftops like Martha had done back then in the Bronx to take photos of the trains and their atmosphere, which was pretty heroic. I wouldn't have done it. And to document this movement, which was very, as we know, very ephemeral. But now it's flourished into a whole new chapter.
Vámonos para el monte, porque el monte me gusta más. Y los tiempos son siempre difíciles. ¿Y qué se creen? Gran mierda, pero no llegan a perro. 50 tan sucio y seco. From an accent to a reaction, still poised. It takes the utter noise to stop the violence. Even the finest offering of beats and rhymes combined with silence can be bored. The beat's nature. In jungles, drums and guns synchronize and finance. High tolerance of hot days. Caliente con pica. And wet cheeks, temper, feet, sleepers don't sleep. In bleak days of past days of cardboard masks, eat new boxes, still relevant. It took a billion dollars to overlook yellow. Instead, money to be used as a tool, but it's incorporated to the rule. Fuck school. I read books. Take second looks. First time. You gotta take murder.
Angle, and by every means.
out. So, yeah, I'm always excited about painting, and it's my purpose in life, obviously. It's also my worst enemy because I suffer a lot in the studio. I think a lot. I really dive into my work and I marinate in it sometimes for too long. But the outcome to me is always more important than something that looks, you know, decorative and proper and politically correct. So I like to just keep sincere and honest with my work because I'm the one that's dishing it out before I lease it out to the world, you know, as I say. And it's been a great journey and it's only just starting. So with that, I'm open for any questions. If you want to go back into what you've seen before, and I can explain it in more detail.
Lee, what building is the helicopter on? That's an extraordinary painting.
Thank you. That was a private commission by a young gentleman that owns that building. And he is a U.S. Marine who never went to Vietnam, but we both felt we did through our experiences on TV and just talking. We had a lot of talks about that particular war, and I just wanted to bring something to the wall that had to do with the clashing of cultures and how some cultures don't understand each other, and cultures sometimes eat each other. Some cultures were in the business of devouring other cultures. So I just felt I wanted to put something that was more neutral, beautiful about the countryside here in Vietnam and Laos, but also that the helicopter is not a gunship, you know, giving the indication that this is the John Wayne theory. We're going in there to change a life, but we're going in with that theory. We're coming out of body bags because we're not understanding the scenario. We all know the outcome of that conflict, which led to other conflicts. So he was in love with it, and he wanted me to paint the entire building. I said, no, I think it's more tasteful that this is more of a thought bubble, and it's coming out of the building, and just leave the rest of the building so you can have a little bit of that background. So he just gave me the green light for what I thought was more, you know, aesthetically powerful. And it was one of my greatest feats because it went seamless. I painted it in about a month's time. Old school Marx Brothers, you know, up in the seesaw. And my greatest, you know, all 14-hour days working nonstop, which is great.
You mentioned somebody, Cooper, who had done a lot of the photography. That was the only woman you mentioned. Were many women involved with this kind of art?
In the painting process itself, very few, unfortunately, that you can count on one finger. The very early young ladies that got involved in the movement, I believe that for the most part, they were kind of like just following the lead of everyone else. I mean, when I first saw it in 1974, I was like, why, who, where, you know, how? My own sister got involved in painting subways with me in 1974. Shortly after that, when we had some run-ins and got away from the law, she was like, oh no, I can't do this. It just was too much. That was right at the height, you know, just when it was ready to ignite. There was a lot of activity on both sides of the fence. So I couldn't blame her, because I was scared as well. But now there is more women than ever before, both influenced, powerful voices, and Lady Pink was at the forefront. Lady Pink was one of the ones that, when I looked her in the eye when I first met her in 1980, 81, I was like, this girl is in it to win it. She's not just someone wanting to strike a pose and just be a token figure. She is here for the long haul. And I respected her and still do as an artist. And it was her perseverance over the years that led the charge that women could get a mouth and have a different perspective on things. And also, and a very powerful voice. And some of them that I've worked with, I'm starstruck by their achievements, and again, they're pushed forward. And now more than ever, I've seen incredible work, both on the streets and on canvas, by women that were influenced, young women that were influenced by this movement. And Jenny Holzer herself was influenced by this movement, by watching what was going on the streets in the late 70s. So it's endless now. And it's probably one of the most inclusive art movements that I've seen or read about ever. So it's because it has theatrics, it's very competitive, but I think the new artists that have a look into the inside of this whole thing know that they don't have to go through all the gauntlet that we went through back in the day of being accepted. You know, oh, you're the baddest painter, you're the first guy that did that, you're the guy that takes the most paint, robs, you know, paints the most cars. It's more about like, we now. So, it's pretty amazing.
I have a question. When you first started in the movement, how did you, since it's kind of secretive in a way, how did you find other artists that were and connect with them that were doing, you know, similar things? How did that happen?
Well, everything was word of mouth. Back then, now it's all Instagram, right? So back then, what I like to call Instagram. Damn, that was incredible. And word of mouth traveled faster probably than it does now, quite honestly, because people in the Bronx knew what was going on in Brooklyn and vice versa. And I right away found out that there were certain places where a lot of these artists were coming, you know, they were just all coming to me, share drawings, sort of like, you know, sort of impromptu speakeasies on the stations themselves. The painting that I showed that said Grand Concourse, that painting is about the Grand Concourse on 149th Street, on the number 2 and 5 and 4 line. That station and that bench, the painting is called Benchmark, was a place, a magnet for all the graffiti writers that had time to meet and share each other's notes and drawings and like, you know, hey, the yard in New Lots is the spot. I would go listen to that because I was like, that's a track. But, and settle beefs, open beefs and settle them right there. A lot of infighting and interesting conversations. Very magical place that doesn't get a lot of, recognition through the whole conversation. The bench was really the first place that was giving notion that we were part of an art group. And I don't think they even noticed that. I didn't at that time. It was just a place to meet and share information. So I would hear the information, but listen to the fine print that I was like, if they're saying that's the yard to go to paint, I don't want to go there. Because then everyone's there. And so are the cops. And so I was a big superhero fan, Marvel Comics, DC Comics, Underground Comics, and I took note to all the guys, all the superheroes that were, you know, they were all anonymous. They all, you know, they had their day jobs, but then they sprung into action when needed. And I felt that I needed to follow that and to survive in a lot of ways, not just in painting in New York, but just being in New York in general. And I took note to medieval Japanese culture, the samurai culture, and the ninja culture. And I put all those dots together and made myself invincible at a time that I needed to be. To protect my integrity, my ego, and my physical self. Because the police back then, some of them were rather cool and some of them were not. And I was harassed by many of them, but I never got caught. And it was just because I kept to myself. So.
I mean, how old were you?
When I started painting?
Yeah.
When I started painting on the subways, I was 14 years old, 1974. And I finished painting in 19, officially, my campaign finished in 84, but I did my last film car, which I never saw again, in 1986. When I came back for that last hurrah, you know, touchdown, as they call it, and I never saw that car again. So yeah, I painted well over 10 years, from my teenage years into my early adulthood. Yes?
Could you talk a little bit about the decision to make individual paintings versus, you know, doing your graffiti work? I mean, it looks like these are paintings on either paper or canvas, or, you know, what that decision is like and how you, why?
Well, in 79, the transition from metal moving objects to, like, an object that's sitting still for being critiqued. It was very difficult for me. I was 19 years old, so was Jean, and we were sharing the studio together along with Fat Five Freddy and another young artist by the name of Jennifer Stein, who was graciously, this studio was given to us by Stan Peskin, who had a huge loft. It was like 4,000 or 5,000 square foot loft. And so I painted my first paintings that went to the show in Rome there. I was having a difficult time with that because I was all of a sudden in the lights. And I wasn't sure what was to come. There was a certain level of weird tranquility being in the subway yards because I was in control of it. I was there by myself. I set up my booby traps, literally. And I was in plain dark clothes, black gloves, everything. It's a whole methodical thing I've read a book about, which I am. But anyway, that kept me safe there. All of a sudden, I was now in the studio environment and creating works that were now going to be in the Bright Lights and Cocktail Society. To be critiqued by Cocktail Society, and it was very uncomfortable for me. But what I found in the paintings is that my voice was immature, and it moved to the next level. And this movement, though it was literally moving on an object, a movement is about moving on, and it's about pushing the envelope and getting to that next platform. And I think that's the way great artists get filtered into a movement to have a voice. So now I feel very comfortable painting on canvas, though I still scratch my head in the studio for days on end, looking at plain white canvas, and again, just trying to mature with the canvas and finding the voice inside the canvas. Putting all these little things that are going on in the, my head is like Freddy Krueger's basement, it's full of that, steam and fire and steel and everything, but, of course I have a love for that time, some guys are, playing that nostalgic card and they love that moment of, being against municipalities and rebelling against their parents or whatever, but, I think that what you saw at the end of graffiti-based art on the subways was meant to be, because the movement had exhausted itself at that point on those subways, and hence that's why I moved on, literally upstairs to the lights, both on the handball walls, which you will see soon after, and in the canvas.
Just two quick questions. These red men and Donald bills, is that what I'm looking at?
Yeah.
Really like that. If you could, maybe say something about it, and then is Odessa still open?
Odessa's?
Yeah, the restaurant down in Odessa.
Yeah, wow, that rang a bell.
It is, yeah.
It is, right?
It is.
Wow, I haven't Yeah, yes it is. There it is. This painting made with real printed matter, and I'll say that just to I don't know, it's just what I felt. I made this painting in 2009. I felt society was going down that same trajectory, you know, that track of moral bankruptcy. And for that reason, I'm fascinated by a lot of things. But one of the things that the irony of fairy tales and sayings, I love that, you know. Can't throw a straight line to save your life. Money doesn't grow on trees. Doesn't fall apart from the apple tree. Cinderella. Little Red Riding Hood. You know, things like that I feel they're funny and they're entertaining, but I look at them differently now as an adult. And this was a painting I was having a very frustrating time trying to create because I didn't know what I was going to create. All of a sudden I started drawing tea and everything that was in my studio at my disposal, just throwing everything on it. Literally, walked away, came back, the thing is dripping, still wet, and I see the trees through the forest. And there's where the idea came. I was like, I had to suffer before I came with the idea. And the idea was like, you know, I must not cut the cherry tree down. I must not tell a lie. So I used that $1 bill as the foliage, as the fall, as the season of fall. In the fall of empires, in the fall of dignity, in the fall of morals, and things like that. So it's called Honest George, based on the $1 bill. And my running joke is that if anyone buys it, purchases it, they get their money back because there's a rebate built into it. Yeah. So, and titles are very important to me. Again, films and music, the title is so integral to the fine print. It tells you the backstory or the subplot, whatever. And I love titles. Sometimes, once in a while, very rarely, my paintings are entitled, but most of them have a title. And sometimes, the titles are written, handwritten, all over my studio, on everything, anything that moves or does not. I write all over the walls, just like Al Diaz did here. I mean, everywhere. And I take those titles or sayings or music, whatever, and lyrics, and I turn them into paintings or vice versa. So I'll make a painting and I have a title for it and I write the title on the wall. It just needs to be part of the conversation on the walls. Someone else, yes?
Could you talk a little bit more about the image that was shortly before this one? It looked like a woman in bed.
Or
not.
I don't know, I just woke up, you know what, I that painting came to be, to me, one day, I was looking out the window of my studio, I was looking at the tenement buildings that were across the street, it was really hot and stank. I mean, it was so hot, it was so misty and humid, as New York summers can be, and I could barely see the roof, and the sun was coming up, and casted this glare across my studio that had, it looked like Venetian blinds, you know, and then I saw this guy running around the roof. I was like, what's he doing? He's just running around. Then as the sun came, got, you know, raised in the horizon, I saw he was a boxer. He was just training. I was like, wow, that's so beautiful. It's like 5 in the morning, the sun. And then I just thought, for some reason, the idea of like stinky, hot, steamy sex in the morning. and that's the first of many paintings that I will make on the series called Pillow Love. And it's still coming to me, Pillow Fight, Pillow Love, whatever. But Pillow Talk, rather, Pillow Talk. And I just felt, it was the first portrait of a dear lady in my life, my wife. And I saw her sleeping one day, and I was like, I'm just taking pictures. She was just sleeping there. I just, you know, I watched certain parts of people's bodies, and the hands say so much, and the shoulders say so much, and the feet, and things like that. And I just saw the way she, I'm like, she'd be a nightmare. She's holding onto that pillow really tight. And she woke up and she saw me there, like, she's taking pictures. Like, oh, ran out the room, and I was like, I'm sorry, baby, this is gonna become a painting. And it did. So it's like my first portrait of a dear lady in my life. But you know, it's really about just that sensual, that language that is in that hand, like that grasping. I don't know what she was dreaming, but just thinking about a moment where two people seemingly look like they're fighting, but they're actually having the most intimate, you know, thing that we all know, the most vulnerable thing we know, right? So I just wanted to talk about sex. Let's talk about sex. You were going to ask a question.
What did your mom think about your mom?
My mother.
She did.
She saved some of my early drawings that I had made in 1966, and I'm glad she did it, because it led me to save all my drawings throughout the 70s. She did know. She found out fairly quickly what I was doing, and I remember telling her, this is very, very ballsy, and I mean, karma, I hope it doesn't come back to me, because now I have children. Woo! I said to her, I remember saying to her, looking her straight in the eye, Mom, do not stop me or try to stop what I am doing, or I will do it even more. I was like, wow! You know, I was expecting a whooping after that, but she was like, she said to me, just come back home to me. Now my father on the other end, a World War II vet, you know, was a little in denial about it, never questioned it, but was, I knew that he ground his teeth that night about it, whether it was for my safety or because, what's he doing out there in the middle of the night destroying property? My mother, I just told her, Mom, I'm painting these wonderful paintings on the trains, and I want you to see them. So she came and benched trains with me. So she came and sat. She sat and watched trains with me.
Wow. Yeah.
And the story behind that is that she lost me in the train one day. And it's a classic story. That you never think that would happen to you, but we got separated from the train one time. And I was probably about 6 or 7 years old, and the doors closed between the train and her. I never saw my mother with such horror and fear in her life. She was a tough cookie. She'd take no shit from anybody, but, you know, very quiet, humble person. But we got separated, and I went off on the train, and I got up for the next stop. Without telling a long story, I stood on that next stop and I waited for the next train to be, that she would get on the train and meet me there. She didn't get on the train because she thought I would come back. So we sat there benching trains before I even paint the train. For the reason of, like, she's coming, he's coming. So we both had that, and there's many moments in our life, in our lives together, that we had this inclination, these views, and we talked to each other in another way, a way in another world. And surely I was like, I know I have to go back. So I went underneath, not on the tracks, but I went underneath, passed through it, got on the next train, knowing that she'd be waiting for me. When I got to that next station and she saw me, it was like, and that's probably why she said, just come back home to me. So I always did. And for that reason, I needed to be invincible. I needed to be invincible, not to, you know, put my mother in a dark place. But I felt that I was in a very claustrophobic, dark place myself, mentally, physically, to enable to spread my wings. You know, so with those paintings on the trains, I felt like I opened the aperture to this dark place. And, you know, it's a magical journey. Any more questions before I go back with y'all? Enjoy. slide projectors back in the day.
Scourge, considered a scourge, the whole graffiti movement. And how much trouble, if you guys got arrested, what happened to you as young kids?
Well, I mentioned part of it this morning. I remember JD cards being like, oh my God, either the in thing or like the most frightening thing. But you either went to Spofford if you was underage, which was worse than jail. It was a juvenile detention center in the Bronx. And I was like, and I came very close to many times, you know, getting killed myself in the trains, but I said I'd rather die than to go there. Spofford was a jail, you know, pretty much a jail, horror house for young kids back in the 70s and 80s. It was infamous. And I said I would do anything and everything in my power to never end up there. And if you was overage, you went to jail. If you was caught for what I was doing, I don't know what would have happened. I do know that the cops did. I'll tell you a little story about two different sets of cops. A set of cops who by then, maybe in the late 40s, early 50s, could not outrun me. I was very fast then, I'm still am, like 58 years old, I come around like lightning. They could not catch me, but they harassed me whenever they seen me on the train station. So one time, they basically took me to a basement bathroom that probably hadn't been used since the 40s, and they proceeded to waterboard, you know, in the toilet. Like, give us information. We know who you are. And I was being a little cranky, but I was like being, you know, kind of like respectful. Like, you know, okay, look, guys, I have nothing on me. They couldn't pin anything on me. And they tried to make me an informant. And I was like, I'll never drop time. And they're like, yes, you will. You know, they gave me a rough time, and then I gave in just to get out of it. And when they gave me their card, which I always say, I wish I would have saved it. They gave me their business card, you know, Officer Wesselman, to give them a dime drop. They let me go, and that's all I needed to have. I walked across the turnstile, I turned around. They looked at me, I looked at them, and they said, anything to add? And I was like, yes. Fuck y'all, fool! And I ripped the card in half, flinged it at them. They chased me out of the station, I was gone. And because of that, they had a runner, a younger cop, that could also not outrun me. So they were pretty mad at me. But because of that, I was the most wanted graffiti artist for 2 years straight, in 77 and 78. Not because of that, but because of what I was doing. The next set of cops who worked on the IRT division said, Lee, you were dangerous. And it was the most beautiful thing I heard. Because they said, after that, they said, because you're an influence. And I was like, that's all I needed to hear. So, and they had pictures of my cars. And it just, you know, the rest is history, as they say.
I gotta give it a try.
Yeah, I do. Danny, where are you?
Thank you. cup chat between you and me, us. We wanted to talk right down to that.
May I not forget the incredible talents of many musicians that I was very much influenced for this piece. Jim Castor, James Brown, Baby Huey, a number of a supporting cast. So if you have any questions, I'm open to, yes.
Hi,
Debbie.
Well, that was the emphasis of the whole movement, like
to create a name, a persona, and elaborate on that. Lee being my middle name, because I hate my first name, soccer moms. I wanted to, at first, that was the protocol. You can't generate that people can know more or less who you are within the community of graffiti writers. Because we were writing our names, that's what we were calling ourselves, writers. Then the last cards that you saw, that I showed there, I decided to take my name out of the equation. I didn't want to focus on that anymore. I wanted to focus on more of a pictorial story. So I thought I had exhausted my name to that point. Some cats kept going with it. They still do to this day. And there's a beauty to that movement within the movement. But I just felt like after a while, it just became too narcissist to me. I'm tired of painting my name in a serial way. I'd rather just take that opportunity to paint something else. Sort of become more anonymous.
Yeah, I did.
Yeah.
I sense
your
little message to your mom.
Yeah, but it was by way of my cop out, if you want to say, like, hey, Ma, come see the train. By the way, your name is in bright lights too. Yeah, I that was my clear signature, if you want to say, of me having her trust. And in return, giving me the strength to her to gain mine, So, it's like, there were times where I was in the yards and I could see way down into Manhattan and see the little twinkle of the World Trade Center, Twin Towers, and I was like, my mother's right to the left of that. She's sleeping, maybe not. She's there and I can see you, and that's where we started. I felt that there was a subliminal thing going on. It's like, okay, Mom, I'm good, I'm almost finished, I'll be home shortly. And so I always put her name. I was like, yeah, you gotta get up with me too. Yeah. Pretty heroic of her to do that, quite honestly. Yes. Well, I mean, Stan Lee being one of the, I forget the names of some of the great pencil, pencilers, but Mad Magazine, the guys that did the art, Robert Crumb, was one of my favorite sarcastic, artists that I admired. But for the most part, I mean, everyone loves Superman and Spider-Man and Batman. I always went for the bad guys. Either Dr. Doom or, the guys under the radar. So Howard the Duck, as opposed to Daffy Duck or Donald Duck, I just thought that he had that kind of suave, he had that charisma that I saw on the streets back in the late 70s and in the music scene and the punk scene. It was like he dressed spiffy, but he was scrappy at the same time. It was very. Yeah, he smoked a cigar, got his hands dirty. I was like, I identify with your character, so I want you to, you know, flank my name and either be in fear of it or be in celebration of it. I still don't know what it is to this day, that wall, what it meant, but I do know that at that time, and this is before I met Fred and Jean and Keith and all these greats from the time, it was at that time that I felt, I am out here in uncharted waters, for everyone to see, including the police, which by the way, the next morning they came by and they looked and I was still just finishing. I had the ladder up against the wall, all the paints, and I made it look totally legit. And they're like, this is fantastic. Would you like some coffee? Because I don't drink coffee. But thank you, sir. And they sped off and they looked totally legit. It was totally against the law. I had arrived as an artist. It was at that point that when that happened, but those cops, compared to the cops in the subways, and doing a wall that was now stationary, a tablet as I call it, that I had arrived as an artist. And this is the stuff, you know, I said, this is the start of something very exciting, nerve-wracking, but very exciting. And also I got the attention of a girl that was sweating in the neighborhood too. God damn. Yes, my man, you came through, thank you very much.
Oh, with technology becoming such a big part of our world, have you ever used technology in any of your art, or do you plan to?
Can you tell? Can you answer that for me? You know, believe it or not, I started a series of paintings using circuit boards from everything. Mm-hmm. Cell phones, computers, laptops, whatever I could find on the street. I was taking loads of it home. You know, during Christmas time, I was like, "This." I had secretly been doing this for a number of years without telling anyone what I was doing. Going to garbage, going to people's garbage cans, like artists all do. You know, we all kind of like collect things because we know there's something in there. There's a language. Started picking everything up, taking it apart in my studio, ending up with hundreds of circuit boards, and I started composing these circuit board abstract paintings using all colors of circuit boards, yellow, red, blue, green, whatever, and then painting on top of that. So it's my way of throwing my wrench in the machine of a systematic, you know, technology is a great tool, but I think no one, they won the battle of, what would you say, the battle of convenience and getting the masses to like accept this, but they lost the war in the way we now only communicate through that. And I feel that the arts, you know, whether it be poetry, film, music, the visual arts, is the spine print that's still left. And my argument is that we're going too fast to stop at the red light, just like a New York City taxi driver. And we need to slow it down, and maybe look each other in the eyes, talk just like this, and maybe bring back penmanship, because it's all lost. It's all lost in this massive thing, and I'm always like afraid of, you know, I still buy things in cash, I got a flip phone, which I forgot back, and, you know, and it's because I just don't want to be so immersed in a world that just doesn't seem human to me, so keep the torch on. Thank you.
Maslow versus a blockbuster, which is much more recent. This is from 2016, so we have an older piece and a much more recent work. I do want to mention we have a fabulous exhibition catalog. It's wonderful, and it has really wonderful accessible essays by Luc Sand, Alexis Adler, Marion Montfortin, and Sarah Driver are all in here. It's wonderful, and we're selling them at cost. Get yours. Sorry, you can get people to autograph it too. So, and students, if you'd like to join all of us for lunch, we are get your lunch in the dining hall and meet us in the alcove conference room. In just a few minutes, we're gonna start walking over there soon. Thanks again.